Europe closer to the Antichrist. And I know that for some of you, this is maybe a new thing, but this is number two message, something that I actually started a year ago at the Jan Markell's Olive Tree Ministries conference in Minnesota, where I actually gave a message called Europe Ready for the Antichrist. And if you haven't watched that one, then go ahead and do that. It's online, it's free of charge, or you can get the DVD if you want. Because this one is basically part two of that message. And so where did we stop last year? That's how I started. And what had happened in Europe since? And also, what are we to expect in the very near future? I must admit that at least one of the quotes that I'm going to have here, Andy used already. So the issue is not only the height. You know, Albert Einstein, a German Jew who fled Germany before the Holocaust, said, the minority, the ruling class at present, has the schools and press, usually the church as well, under its thumb. This enables it to organize and sway the emotions of the masses and make its tool of them. So true. We're talking about, and it's no longer a secret, we're talking about a cartel of international bankers, industrialists, may I say insurance companies, may I say media people. It's people who basically control your finances, control your panic mode, create the panic, and control your understanding of situations. And they're based mostly in Western Europe and in North America. The names of certain families persist over long periods of time. Some of the most important names are the Rothschilds, the Rockefellers, Morgan, Lazard, Warburg, Schroeder, and Schiff. And the list is not too long. Very few families control so much of this world. And people ask me, as a Jew, aren't you afraid to mention Jewish names here? No. I'm not, because I don't think they consider themselves as Jews anyway. If anything, they think and play in a level that is far above and beyond religious affiliation. They are servants of satanic effort to bring down humanity's population to under 500 million people, and they're not even ashamed of it. They'll do whatever it takes, take any dirty trick possibly can be found to just do that. They used to hide those things. They no longer do, as we just heard. And as we just heard, from the same page of the same book, some even believe that we are part of a secret cabal working against the best interests of the United States. And that's not only United States. Characterizing my family, myself as internationalist, and of conspiring with others around the world to build a more integrated global political and economic structure, one world, if you will. If that's the charge, I stand guilty, and I'm proud of it. By the way, he wrote it in his memoir, page 4 or 5. But when he went to Europe, to Germany, in one of the Bilderbergers meeting, in the Bilderberg meeting in June 91 in Baden, in Germany, he actually said, it would have been impossible for us to develop our plan for the world if we had been subjected to the lights of publicity during those years. But the world is now more sophisticated and prepared to march towards a world government and the supranational sovereignty of an intellectual elite and world bankers is surely preferable to the national autodetermination practiced in past centuries. So they're talking about it. They understand times are changing, and what used to be done under the radar, in the secret, can no longer be done so. And few people kind of found out that there is a plot, and it's not American plot, and it's not a new plot. And they actually pointed at that. And one of them was Congressman Larry McDonald, who actually gave a speech in Congress in America and said that the drive of the Rockefellers and their allies is to create a one-world government combining super capitalism and communism under the same tent, all under their control. Do I mean conspiracy? Yes, I do. I am convinced there is such a plot, international in scope, generations old in planning, and incredibly evil in intent. So what do you do with such a man? You just kill him. And what if he is not alone? Well, you kill everybody with him. And he was on board a Korean airline 747 jet that was shut down by the Soviets. And he died, of course. And it's interesting because America, being the leader of the free world, was on the fast track, direct path to be the main player in moving the world towards that global government. But the effective and fervent prayer of the righteous man avails much. I'll never forget the day. It was Saturday. I went to church in, you know, in Haifa in Israel, and my father-in-law gave a message on shepherds. And of course, from Ezekiel in chapter 31, 32, you can see what a true heart of a shepherd is and how God will remove a shepherd that takes care of himself and not of his flock. And at that time, that was a couple days before the elections in America, I remember I could see in my mind what Hillary Clinton did for the sake of her own husband while she was Secretary of State, generating millions of dollars to their, not only to their nonprofit, but also to their own pocket directly by arranging speaking engagements for him in specific countries such as Saudi Arabia and Qatar. And at the same time, she wrote an email admitting that she knows that at the time Qatar and Saudi Arabia were behind the establishment of ISIS. And I thought to myself, the Secretary of State of the United States of America not only knows exactly how ISIS started, because ISIS started because of the Sunni effort to stop the expansion of the Shiites in Iraq towards Syria as they saw the almost collapse of the Syrian regime. And the Syrian regime is a faction of the Shiite Islam. They thought the last thing we can afford right now is a sequence of Shiite Islamic territory from Iran across Iraq all the way to the Mediterranean Sea. So we must do something about it. So that's how ISIS began, and of course it went out of control, and that beast started biting those hands that fed. And it's interesting because the Secretary of State of the United States of America, knowing who started ISIS, still kept receiving donations from those same places. So I thought, you know, I better go and go on Facebook Live and just call the people in America. Don't think it's over. Just go and vote. Because if you will vote, God will do his part. If you will show that you're not willing to live with such a thing, God will do his part. But as long as you do nothing, you can't expect anything to change. And I remember that. I strongly felt that Donald Trump is going to win. And I actually, that day of the election, I went to bed without even watching the results. And when I woke up in the morning and I saw that he's the president, I wasn't surprised. In fact, the first thing that came to my mind, I'm not even sure if he will end up his presidency. And I was speaking that same morning online, thinking to myself, I don't know if he knows what he's going to find out in that swamp that he pledged to drain. But you know that prayers of the righteous people avails much. But you also need to know that the Bible says that the Antichrist is going to show his true face once the restrainer is out of his way. In other words, the restrainer, the Holy Spirit, as long as he's still here, and we're still here, has the power to restrain things. And I was thinking to myself, if people will go to vote, and they will do their part, and God will do his part, this is a great display of a restrainer, because America was out of control by that point. And that is exactly what happened. The efforts to push for globalization, one world government, and a new world order suffered a major setback with Donald Trump elected as president, and the platform has officially moved to Europe. You have to understand something. Donald Trump is an accident. He even surprised himself. It's an accident in a global scope that its effect is beyond America, and we feel it all over the world right now. Now, remember I said a few slides ago that gang of bankers and of industrialists is centralized in Western Europe and in Northern America. Well, Donald Trump shows up and says right there in his inauguration speech, everybody in Washington is infected. Literally. He didn't even say Democrats. Everyone. Let me tell you something. You may not know that, but he has more people detesting him amongst the Republicans than the Democrats. There is, or there was, almost no difference between Republicans and Democrats when it comes to the Washington, D.C. elite. And all of them were working for the same group of bankers and industrialists, the same group. And I want you to know that when Julian Assange was interviewed a month before the elections, he said Trump has no chance. And then they asked him, why do you say that? He says, because there is no establishment that is for him. He says, everyone is for Hillary Clinton. The intelligence, the military, the bankers, the stock market, and the media, and the entertainment are all on her side. And then he said, probably, maybe the only thing, if you can even call it establishment, is the evangelical Christians. That's what he said. Well, you know what happened. One establishment just made the difference here. And Trump realized the minute he became president, the biggest problem he has is not from the outside, it's from the inside. Moving Comey aside so fast was a brilliant move of someone who understands that as long as that man is there, his days are numbered. When the head of your Secret Service is the chief leaker to the media that hates you anyway because it's owned by people who don't want you there anyway, you've got a problem. Not to mention many other things that he knows. Now, why do you think he knows all things? Because he was the guy everybody wants to be friends of. So when he was still under the billionaire title, mostly Democrats were his friends. They came to his mansion, to his big estate, and they wanted to go to all of his parties and have him endorsing all of their things, and they will tell him all of their secrets. Not understanding and not knowing the guy is going to become president and understand and know exactly how things work. And that is exactly why there is an unprecedented effort to remove a sitting president in the United States like no other time in history. But I didn't come to talk about America because I just said that it's officially moved to Europe. So much so that Obama was sent by the elite to make sure that at least in Europe that accident is not going to happen. And he was on a mission to go and make sure that Macron is going to become the president of France. It's funny how people are talking about the Russian interference in the American elections. Now, make no mistake, as the leader of the free world, America interfered in more elections than any other country on planet Earth. Even in the last elections in Israel, where Obama sent his own advisors and used millions of dollars from the State Department budget to feed an organization called V16, Victory 16, that will try to defeat Benjamin Netanyahu. And Benjamin Netanyahu was an accident. Our accident. And the way they introduced Macron was interesting. They introduced him as Europe's savior, walking on water. Maybe can help people that drown over there, as you can see. Interesting how they play this whole thing. Now, why is it so interesting? And let's skip this one, okay. First of all, there is a system how to create what they want to create, world government. First of all, what you do is you create a crisis. Once you create a crisis, you move on. And what is the crisis that they created? The New York Times said that Obama jump-started the Arab Spring. Now, you cannot say that the New York Times is anti-Obama. At the time when they wrote it, they actually praised Obama for jump-starting the Arab Spring. They just didn't know it's going to turn into a Muslim winter, not an Arab Spring. And more than 700,000 people died since the beginning of the Arab Spring. Not to mention more than 5 million displaced people. Not to mention people that lost everything and they're still in their country. Abused and taken advantage. It's interesting because we just heard about Islam and being, you know, such a peaceful religion, some claim. I wonder why none of the refugees ran to the Muslim countries. They all went to the West and not to the East. And I wonder why none of those countries even opened their gates to these people. Well, there's a reason for it. Now, what happened is very simple. The globalists, which is a cartel, and they have meetings every year in specific places around the world. Meetings that are closed to the media. You're not even allowed to be there. They appointed the US president to go and jumpstart the Arab Spring. And what they didn't know is that by doing so, he created or jumpstarted two interesting events that are playing a major role in Bible prophecy. First, you all know that the Syrian civil war started because of Obama's, you know, Arab Spring. It started with someone in Tunisia that burned himself alive. It continued all the way to Algeria. It then moved on to Egypt and got all the way to the city of Daraa in Syria. During a funeral, there was a demonstration. Assad was so afraid that he's going to have what all the other leaders had earlier, and he just ordered his soldiers to open fire and spray and kill anyone as long as, you know, let's kill it when it's young. Within a week, everything spread out to other cities. But it was a popular movement. It was the people wasn't terrorists at that time. When the terrorists saw that there's chaos in Syria, they knew that it's time to act. And within 6 months, the whole uprising in Syria was hijacked at that time by Jabhat al-Nusra and al-Qaeda. And when that happened, there was a need for some other organization that started a year later, and that was ISIS. The Islamic State of Iraq and Syria. And ISIS becomes now the official reason, for Russia to go in, Iran to go in, and Turkey to go in. They don't tell you that ISIS, they could care less about ISIS. You know, whoever destroys ISIS right now, it's mostly the Kurds. They don't tell you that. The Russians come because of the gas and the oil. The Iranians want to spread the Shia, and the Turks are coming there just to stop the expansion of the Kurds. That's what's going on. So, without knowing, Obama actually brought us to the verge of the fulfillment of Ezekiel 38, bringing all the players to the right place, preparing the stage. But what he also did, as a result of the crisis up, started another crisis down below. Look, a lot of people don't know that. But when Hillary Clinton ran for president on behalf of the Democratic Party 4.5 years ago, she needed a winning card. Her advisors told her, go and fight a war that will be your war. And at that time, she received complaints from the French president that he is not happy with what's going on in Libya. Gaddafi was about to introduce a new trade method with oil, for oil, based on gold, and he will call it the gold dinar, and we're no longer going to trade with dollars, U.S. dollars. And of course, French assets are all over Libya. France used to control Libya. They were afraid they're going to lose everything. So the French press to do something about it. All the advisors of Hillary Clinton were bankers and industrialists. They didn't want to lose the U.S. dollar at the moment. And so she was actually appointed to convince NATO to bomb Libya and completely take Gaddafi out. And she, by the way, she's so happy about it. She said, there's a video you can see. We came, we saw, he died. And she's laughing. Gaddafi told Europe, I'm the one that stops all the African immigration into your continent. You remove me, they're going to invade into your continent. And in order to stop them, I need money. The Europeans don't like to be asked for money. Well, you know what? Gaddafi was removed. And unlike what you may think, majority of immigrants to Europe are not even Syrians. The Syrians are stuck in Lebanon, Jordan, and Turkey. The vast majority are Africans. Exactly what Gaddafi said that is going to happen. So you created a crisis, you remove that cork, now the flood comes all the way, and it's very interesting because I just want you to know that for every boat that left the coast of Libya, a boat left the coast of Italy, and they were about to meet in the center. The boat that left the coast of Italy are the rescue teams. They all knew exactly the route of each boat. And guess who is the one who sponsored the rescuers? In fact, he said, national borders are the obstacle. And do you think he's not even ashamed of that. He said that a collaboration between him and MasterCard will actually profit from the immigration. The thing is this, for every person they rescue, they receive money. Now, the people who were on the boat paid already money to those who smuggled them. The Italian mafia got money to be able to get them in. There's a whole system that is making tons of money, and there is someone who is making money on all of those that are making money. They say that Europe is unable to confront the migrant crisis, and it is committing suicide. So there is a crisis, a major crisis, and the crisis is there, and the crisis creates division. And the division can be within countries, not only between countries. Within the countries, for example, Germany just had elections, and guess, for the first time since the fall of the Third Reich, since the Nazis are out, for the first time, a very right-wing anti-immigration party is winning substantial number of seats in parliament, in the Reichstag, in the Bundestag. And they are known as the Alternative für Deutschland, alternative for Germany. Stunning success. You see, when you have one situation, you get the counter one, and then that battle brings that which is in the middle. You can actually see that beyond the, you know, you have the same thing going on also in Austria, and the same things goes on in the Netherlands and other places. You see, there's a lot of people that are unhappy with what's going on, even within Sweden and Finland and Norway. But also between countries, you can clearly see that there is tension in Europe. The European states deeply divided on refugees crisis before key summit. The illegal immigration divides the EU as the eastern parts, such as Poland, Hungary. You know that the Hungarian Prime Minister, Orban, he was the best friend of Soros. And Soros paid for Orban's university fees when Orban was young. But when Orban becomes Prime Minister and he realizes what Soros is doing, he comes against him. And he says, it's not going to happen here. Hungary, the Czech Republic, Slovenia, and more, they refuse to open their borders. And Europe may be under the European Union, but is far from being united. Just as Daniel had in his dream, the feet, everything else already was fulfilled, the feet are made of iron and clay. It is a divided nations of Europe, not the united ones. And so we can see that the leader of the European Union, the president of the European Union, President Juncker, he delivered a State of the Union on September 13, 2017, and look what he said. He said that EU should start an army without consent from the voters. In other words, they look at the helplessness of the people, and they say, now we can push forward our agenda. If that's not enough, there is a call to combine the Commission and the Council presidencies, a move that would transform the EU leadership and consolidate authority in a single figure who would campaign for the post. For the first time since the fall of the Roman Empire, there will be a new European leader for all of Western Europe. Did you know that the Roman Empire ruled between the 27 BC to 395 AD? That was the last time we saw the Roman Empire. And the reason why we have an idea that there has to be a revived Roman Empire in the future is because when Daniel talked in the 70 weeks prophecy in chapter 9, he talked about the same people who destroyed the temple. From amongst them will come a leader in the 70th week. And it's very interesting because in 117, the Roman Empire reached its peak. Look how big it was at the time. Controlled not only Western Europe, but also the entire Balkan area, the area of Turkey, Syria, Lebanon, Israel, Egypt, and of course, all the northern part of Africa. But after that, you may not know that, but the Roman Empire was sort of divided. And there was the Western Roman Empire that just lasted less than 100 years. And that is when the rest became Christian, so to say, and became Byzantine. So the Roman Empire continued in a way. And believe it or not, the Byzantine Empire, which was on the eastern part, lasted for quite a long time, and in its peak, the Byzantine Empire, as you can see, was mostly on the eastern part. Pay attention that Western Europe and Spain are still somewhere else. Now, many people talk about the German Nazi Party time period as the Third Reich. Have you ever considered who was the First Reich or the Second Reich? How come we got to the Third Reich already? Well, if you Google First Reich, you know what you're going to get? I'll tell you what you're going to get. you're going to get the Holy Roman Empire. Did you know that the Pope at the time, and I'm talking about Pope Leo III, he crowned the Frankish King Charlemagne as emperor on the day after Christmas, December 25th, the year 800. And from the year 800 until 1806, which is the year Napoleon brought an end to this thing, there was a Holy Roman Empire. Heiliges Römisches Reich. That's how they called it at the time. That is the First Reich. And it's interesting because this would have been its territory, and I know it's a little dark, but this, the biggest country is Germany. And all the small ones are all around it. That's central, western central Europe. I don't know, can you see the rest of Europe there? It's a little too, I don't know if you can see it on this screen. It's a little bit too bright, but, or else you would have seen it. Anyway, the Second Reich, believe it or not, the German Empire between 1871 and 1918, until the end of World War I, it's known as the Second Reich. And already during that time, that was the size. There was a book written in 1923 by a German author called Arthur Müller van der Brück, and the ideology of which heavily influenced the Nazi Party was in this book. The book formulated an ideal of national empowerment which resounded throughout a Germany desperate to rebound from the Treaty of Versailles. You see, when Germany was humiliated at the end of World War I, they lost their economy, they lost their pride and dignity, they were surrendered inside a train wagon in Versailles, France. By the way, that same train wagon is where Hitler later on will bring the French and say, now you surrender right here. And he called his book Das Dritte Reich, the Third Reich. And this is why the Nazis, in there since 1933 to 1945, that's how they call themselves, the Third Reich. And of course, the Nazis took over most of Europe and expanded, and they had big dreams to take over even all over Russia. They came all the way to Leningrad at the time, if you know. So what about a Fourth Reich? I don't like to sound dogmatic, but I'm Israeli. But 2 years ago, the CIA revealed secret documents that were classified until 2 years ago regarding Adolf Hitler's last years. And you may think that I'm talking about 1945, but I'm not. I'm talking about his escape from Berlin all the way to South America via Spain, to Spain in a plane, and from Spain to South America in a submarine, all the way to the coast over there. And what he found there is already German preparation there for a Fourth Reich. Now, when I was in Berlin and I went to see the Pergamon Museum, you know how many Americans were angry that there was a replica of the Baal arch? Well, that's just a replica, yeah? The Germans went all the way to the city of Pergamon in Turkey, took the actual altar from there and brought it all the way to the museum in Germany, named it the Pergamon Museum, and it is the altar of Zeus, known also as the seat of Satan, in the center of Berlin. By the way, I was in Berlin few weeks ago, and I'm telling you one, you know, I speak German, love German people. In Berlin, maybe 2 out of 10 were Germans. And I can tell you one thing, if the rapture took place then or now in Berlin, nobody would know. I'm not saying that there are no good Christians there. Trust me, I know them. They're not that many. But there, it's not only there, even in Holland, there's very few. I mean, I've been to Amsterdam enough times to see how dark the place is, yet there are few very, very devout Christians there. But overall, Europe is completely becoming Babylon. So much so that Europe invited Babylon into its own territory. If all the wars of the ancient empires against each other were actually in Babylon, Europe is the first one to invite Babylon to its territory. And not only that we have such a Babylonian thing there, but I want you to see that in the same museum, they brought the Ishtar Gate of Babylon to stand right there. In other words, they're saying this is the gateway into Babylon. If that's not enough, and you're still wondering, is that guy for real? I can tell you that the foreign reports reported that Germany is quietly building a European army under its command. The president of Germany, the chancellor of Germany during the fall of the walls was Helmut Kohl. He's known as the father of the unified Germany. And he just passed away a few months ago. And you would expect his funeral to be in Germany with German flags, honored by the German people. What you didn't see is that his body was brought to Strasbourg to the European Parliament, covered by a European flag. Do you see a German flag there, by the way? I don't. Honored, not as the German chancellor by the German people, honored by world leaders, as if Germany is the leader of Europe. Recently, they conducted a survey among the Europeans. One of the questions was, how likely do you expect that a terrorist attack like what happened in Paris, in Brussels, or in Berlin could happen in your country? And very likely to somewhat likely was almost 90%. In other words, the Europeans don't feel safe. They expect terrorist attack any minute. Then they asked them, how serious a problem do you believe is that illegal immigrants are coming into your country? 81% believes that it's either very serious or somewhat serious. Then they asked them, how much do you trust the following institution? Your own government, for example. Half only trust their governments. My point is this. When you don't feel safe, when you admit that there is a big problem, and when you don't trust your own government, this is the fertile ground that the elite needs to push forward its own agenda. They create a crisis. They create division within countries and between countries. They create distrust, lack of safe feeling of people and trust of their own government. And that chaos and despair and hopelessness are needed in order to wait for a deliverer. And they will accept him the moment he will surface. There's an American person who is a member of one of the most prestigious institutions, who came to visit the European Parliament. And he came to visit that place, and he came to this conclusion. Europe is committing demographic suicide systematically depopulating itself in what British historian Niall Ferguson has called the greatest sustained reduction in European population since the Black Death in the 14th century. Europe is so depopulating itself right now that it's scary. So what are the elite, what is the elite doing? Pushing new people in. Now, the unwillingness to create the future in the most elemental sense by creating new generations is at the root of many of Europe's problems, including its difficulties assimilating immigrants and its fiscal distress. When an entire continent, healthier, wealthier, and more secure than ever before, deliberately chooses sterility, the most basic cause for that must lie in the realm of the human spirit, in a certain soaring about the very mystery of being. Now, he came to one of the parliament members, the Italian one of all people, and he says, "What are you doing?" And that Italian guy answered in an Italian way. And he said to him, "Look, we know we're finished. We're trying to arrange things so that we can die comfortably in our beds. Don't you Yanks come over here and start stirring things up." That's how bad things are in Europe. Did you know that the prime ministers of, or presidents of Europe's largest economies and of all the European members of that exclusive global club, the G7, are without children? Did you know that? All of their leaders are childless. Germans, Angela Merkel, Great Britain's Theresa May, Italy's Paolo Gentiloni, France's Emmanuel Macron, they're all childless. Add to those also the Dutch Prime Minister, Mark Rutte, and the childless Prime Minister of Luxembourg, Javier Bettel, and something quite striking comes into focus. Of the 6 founding members of what has evolved into the European Union, 5 are now led by childless prime ministers or presidents. Quite interesting. We see also a great moral decline in Europe. Great in ways of not even appreciating human life anymore. The story of Charlie Gard, the baby that suffered from a very rare disease, was admitted to a hospital in London, and we know that the Americans offered help, but the London court ordered the hospital to disconnect him from life support. And he died. Although the Americans offered help of a new treatment, you could see that human life isn't regarded anymore. In fact, they say that so many people across Europe, even in the Netherlands, many are actually disconnected from life support almost on a daily basis. There's no need to spend so much effort and money. Life isn't that. We need to reduce population, remember. If that's not enough, a fashion show with satanic figures is held in an Anglican church in London, on the altar. The British historian Arnold Toynbee said, "The nations are ready to give the kingdoms of the world to any one man who will offer us a solution to our world's problems." The first president of the United Nations General Assembly, Paul Henry Spaak, who also was a prime minister of Belgium and one of the early planners of the European Common Market, as well as the Secretary General of NATO, affirmed, and he says, "We do not want another committee, and we have too many already. What we want is a man of sufficient stature to hold the allegiance of all the people and to lift us up out of the economic morass into which we are sinking. Send us such a man, and whatever he be, God or devil, we will receive him." So, first you create a crisis, then you create division, And now you offer hope. How do you offer hope? The hope has to be young, attractive, I say, I guess, full of charisma. And the hope has to somehow be something new, because the old isn't supplying the merchandise. So it started in 2015 when the Greek elected Alexis Tsipras, 43-year-old, and then the Europeans said, that's too old. And it continued with Emmanuel Macron, who at the age of 39 became the president of one of the largest economies in the world. And it continued this month with a 31-year-old Sebastian Kurz being the prime minister of Austria. They get younger and younger and younger, and they emerge as a result of the crisis and the division that the immigration in Europe had created. And now everybody's planning, as we heard earlier, that there will be a position for an all-European leader. And that's the unknown. The Antichrist cannot be a false messiah unless he is first accepted by the Jews as messiah. See, people don't understand that. What makes him a messiah for people is the fact that he brings prosperity, peace, and a rebuilding of a temple. That's in the minds of the Jewish people, the job of the Messiah. And he can be a nice person to many people around the world, but unless he's nice to the Jewish people and lures them into peace and allows them to build a temple, then he's not the guy. You see, people kept writing me and said, Erdogan, he's the Antichrist. I said, the most biggest anti-Semite in Europe today is Erdogan. Not even a single Jewish ant or cockroach will vote for such a man. We can't stand the guy because he denies the Holocaust even. It has to be someone who will have the charisma to somehow lure the Jewish people into a deal that they will be tempted to sign on. Solving the problems of Europe and giving hope to the world will not be enough. He has to appeal to the Jewish people. His worldwide fame and power means nothing if he is not accepted by the Jewish people. Now, probably you're scratching your head right now saying, European non-Jew accepted by Jews as Messiah? Well, let me show you something interesting. Napoleon was almost regarded by the Jewish people in his own country as the Messiah. Let me show you a coin that was minted exactly 200 years ago. Napoleon, emperor and king on the left, and on the right, Napoleon dressed like an emperor, like a god actually, and he's giving the Ten Commandments to the Jewish people. And underneath there it says the Great Sanhedrin. And it is the Grand Sanhedrin, excuse me, May 30th, 1806. Remember 1806? Napoleon stopped. Remember the Great Roman Empire? Remember? This is it. Ladies and gentlemen, we are witnessing a very desperate continent that has all the ingredients to produce very fast the man of sin that we all know is going to somehow mislead Israel to think that he will bring peace. Now, How can we have peace in the temple, on the Temple Mount, when Islam is a vibrant, strong religion around the world? You and I know that it's impossible. Every little thing that we do around the Temple Mount is almost World War III right now. So how are we going to do that? In order to bring peace, you have to have a war. In order to cause a religion to either disappear or to go through such a change, you need a very bad war. And this is exactly what I believe is going to happen in Ezekiel's war. Ezekiel's war will be a war that Israel will not enjoy the help of any country but the Lord himself. And when the Lord God of Israel is going to show his hand, and those countries like Iran and Turkey that will represent both the Shiite and the Sunni Islam, as well as Russia that represents world empires that is after money and greed, when they will be defeated, not by Israel, but by the Lord God of Israel, and when America and Saudi Arabia and Europe will just stand aside and just criticize this whole thing, but do nothing about it, then it will be inevitable that neither from Russia that is defeated, nor from America and that is not helping Israel, someone is about to emerge and introduce peace to that very, very wounded part of the world. And at that point and at that time when Islam has been officially defeated, you have to understand something. You cannot say Allah is the greatest day and night and lose in all of your wars. There's something that is already registering in their own mind already. I can see that. I follow Arab media, Muslim. I follow them. More and more and more Muslim leaders are convinced that Israel is no longer the problem. It's actually their own religious system that is the problem. And right now, in the midst of Europe, there is millions of confused Muslims that ran away from Islam. They ran away from that which Islam caused them into an area that now is introducing, be good, do good, all is good. You don't have to convert to any religion. You just have to be a good person. Such speeches are given by the popes. So they think, if I want to be accepted by the Europeans, I better not be any more radical Muslim. I better actually assimilate to the system. In fact, I would like to tell you that when the French candidate to prime minister, or to president, Marie Le Pen, when she introduced her platform, she said, look, I don't want those burqas worn by the Muslim women. But we have a Supreme Court. We cannot ban one thing from one religion only. So in the quest and for the sake of defending ourselves from Islam, we're going to order the Jews not to wear yarmulkes and Christians not to wear crosses. In other words, religion is stripped off from everyone in the name of fighting radical Islam. People write me from Berlin and from other parts of Germany, teachers that are being asked not to show up to work with a cross because it offends people. Europe is becoming religious, or religionless almost. You know, I was in Germany, I couldn't see religion there. I mean, you would think that the Muslims in Berlin are super radical. No, they're not. Everybody's tired of religion over there. I told you, the rapture takes place, no one there will even know. Europe is getting tired of religion, and that is exactly what we see now. Colossians 3, verses 1 and 2 says, If then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. When you, the believers, see that which is going on, it can be depressive if we look at the things as they are. Because we see evil in its purest form. What we need is to remind ourselves that we have a much greater hope than this. We have a blessed hope. And in order to understand our blessed hope, we need to look for our destination. It is not here. It is there. The Bible says, seek those things which are above. Where above? Where Christ is. Where is he right now? At the right hand of God. This is where we're going to be. That's our destination. That's what we need to focus on. That's the hope we need to hold on. The Bible says that our citizenship is in heaven, from which we eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Are you eagerly waiting? Who will transform? By the way, it's not lovely. I told you there's a typo. Our lowly. Lowly bodies. Take your two fingers, please, and pinch yourself right now. You're dying. Take a picture from 20 years ago. Put it right next to you. You're dying. You have lowly body. Oh, I'm drinking green tea every day. You have green lowly body. I work out every day. You have muscular lowly body. I run every day. You'll die healthy. He will transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to his what? Okay. When did Jesus receive his glorious body? After his? Exactly. So, remember what 1 Corinthians 15 says. Behold, I tell you a mystery. Not all of us are going to sleep, but all are going to change. Look at you. We're going to change. We're going to change. The body cannot, this body cannot make it in heaven. I'm sorry to tell you that. Yeah, in this body, no one enters heaven. You have to be changed. He had to be changed. He had to receive that glorious body in order to make it to heaven. According to the working by which he is able even to subdue all things to himself. So, I hope that I made it clear this afternoon, following the teaching this morning, that definitely Israel is ready, the Middle East is ready. We just heard wonderful teachings of the signs of the end and what's going on all around. And I need you to understand that there is a place in this world that is ready to produce the Antichrist. And the question is not if Europe is ready, Israel is ready, the Middle East is ready. The question is, are you ready? Do you know that this is it? We're gonna come to the point where we want to reflect on the things that we just heard. And as our eyes are going to be closed and our heads bowed down, all of us, please. If there's anyone here this afternoon that in light of what we just heard throughout the whole day, the Holy Spirit is showing him that he is not ready. And as our eyes are closed and our heads are bowed down, today is your day if you choose to obey to the voice of the Holy Spirit. And if it's you today and nobody can see, may you just raise your hands so we can acknowledge, I can acknowledge, and we're going to pray together. Yeah, I see those hands. I see anyone? I see hands in the back. I see hands here in the middle. Father, we thank you so much that you don't want any of your children to be lost, but all to come to the saving knowledge of Jesus. And even when some count slack, you don't slack. This slackness that people think of is actually in their own heads, imagination. For you, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like one day. You really don't want anyone to perish. However, we know, Father, that the day is coming, and when we do not even expect, we're going to be out of here. We'll be at work or in school or at home. One will be taken and another will stay. And the reason you never gave us the day or the hour is so we will be ready at all time. So Father, we ask today, in light of everything we heard today, if there is anything in our hearts, in our mind, anything that we store elsewhere that is not of you, that actually separates us from you, we today put all of these things on the altar. And we want to be ready. Not just to be ready, we want to be found doing our Father's business when you come back. To be watchmen on the walls. Not only to understand the day, the times, and the seasons, but to be a way for the world to also know that. As Isaiah the prophet said, Hineni, here I am. Shlacheni, send me out. Today, Father, we offer ourselves as living sacrifice, telling you, here we are, send us out. So first, Father, we ask that you will help us change our ways. And then, we want to make ourselves available for you. Time is short, and the fields are packed with so much harvest, and the workers are few. So we today offer ourselves. We want you to find us as faithful and good servants when you come. We thank you that he who promised is faithful. And we thank you, Father, that we can see that the day indeed is approaching. And we ask all of this in the matchless, beautiful, amazing, powerful name of the King of Kings, and the Lord of Lords, of the one who came as the Lamb of God and is now seated as the Lion of the tribe of Judah, and he will come back to reign with us as the King of Kings. In the name of Yeshua, Jesus, we pray. And all of God's people say, Amen. Amen.